papers in New York and Washington State. Wise's most recent book is Between a Rock and a Hard Place, Racism and White Denial in the Age of Obama, which explores the issues of race within the context of the Obama presidency. He is also the author of Wagon Like Me, Reflections on Race from a Privileged Son. Also, Affirmative Action, Racial Preference in Black and White, a collection of his essays, Speaking Treason Fluently, Anti-Racist Reflections from an Angry White Male. Wise received his BA from Tulane University and anti-racism training from the People's Institute for Survival and Beyond, both in New Orleans. At this time, let's give a warm Hamilton College welcome to Mr. Kahlani.
That's division. That's the very definition of the concept. Racism is is divisive, but discussing it is not. That is no more the problem than discussing domestic violence is the problem. Domestic violence is the problem, not bringing it up in marriage counseling. So when we have to have a conversation about a problem, we have to identify the source of the division at the source, not in our discourse about it. Some among us would apparently rather seek unity on the cheap by ignoring the structural realities that divide us, no matter whether we speak of them or not. So be it. But they ought not be allowed to create paradigms of academic and intellectual virtue when they do so. And so for those of you who are here, I appreciate the opportunity to be divisive, apparently on your behalf, to inject some level of discomfort into your academic experience. I think it will be for the better, just like it was for the better when I had to sit and listen to a certified war criminal by the name of Henry Kissinger speak to me when I was a sophomore in college. I lived through that, and this too shall pass. Now, having said all of that, which was naturally completely extemporaneous because I didn't even know about the division until I got here, let me actually get into the substance of my remarks and let me back off a bit from the division and tell you a story that is really not particularly divisive and really not at all controversial. In fact, it's a story that doesn't have anything to do with racism. It's a story that doesn't have anything to do with privilege, per se. It's a story that isn't directly about any of the subjects I intend to discuss, but at the end of the story, I think you'll see how it is related to the subjects, even if it's not the purpose of the story itself to discuss it. It's a story about something that happened to me shortly after I graduated from college, which was 19 years ago, this past May. As you heard in the intro, I graduated from Tulane University in New Orleans, Louisiana, May of 1990. And when I got out of college, I thought it would be a really great idea to move into a very large and frankly dilapidated house. But that's not really the point. A very large house with nine other people. Now, I hope you'll get a lot out of my talk. I can't make any promises. I certainly can't force you to. But if you get nothing else out of it, please take at least this away as life advice. Do not, I speak from experience, make the mistake of thinking to yourself upon graduation from this fine institution that among the better ideas that you might indulge would be moving into a really large house with nine other people, because it isn't going to work out. Oh, we'll save money. And that was our thinking. I mean, that was our logic, right? Because we were broke, and I have bad news for you. When you graduate, you will likely be as well. And so you'll do all kinds of crazy things, like moving to a really large house with nine other people, because you'll save money. You think that that's all that matters when you're broke. And stick around, you'll find out that there's more to it. Now, it was cheap. Look, it was $525 a month. I don't mean the first time in total. Even in $1,990, that was pretty good. $52.50 a month. I'm not good at math, but that was easy. But $52.50 a month, you add the utilities and the cable bill, and I mean that internet back then, right? This is Stone Age, we barely had electronic typewriters, but we put all the bills together, paid for our groceries in common, right? We sort of called it a co-op, trying to make it political. It was just a dirty old past. Even when you added all the other bills, it was still less than $100 a month. So on the economic level, this was a pretty good deal. But about 6 weeks in, I came to understand viscerally why I would have been better off to just live alone, save my money, and hell, move home with my parents, anything other than this, because it didn't work out so well. And here's how I came to understand it. I came back from work one night, about 6 weeks into this process of living with all these folks, and I got home, and I noticed one of my roommates was making dinner for the evening on the left front burner of our stove, because we didn't just split the expense, we also just turned the cooking for one another. And this happened to be his night, and he was making dinner, and there's a pot of gumbo, because it's New Orleans, and that's what you do at least once a week. And man, it smelled good, it looked good, it even had shrimp in there. Not many, I told you we were broke, but it had like three of those really little fishy shrimp. And you can't even taste them. You can't taste them, but you know psychologically they're in there. So you think, well, I got seafood gumbo. Yeah, seafood gumbo, you can taste that. But you know it's in there. It makes you feel more wealthier than you really are. It smelled great, and it looked great. But when he asked me if I wanted any, I had to say, look, I'm going to pass. Because even though it does look good, I just just had dinner downtown before I came back uptown, and I'm really not hungry. Do me a favor, I want you to take the gumbo and you put it in some Tupperware, put it in the fridge, save it for tomorrow. I'll take some for lunch because it looks great. He said, cool, I'll do that. I said, great, I went upstairs, I'll have some roommates, did a little work I was behind on, watched a little bit of TV as I all went to bed sort of early. Woke up the next morning, came downstairs, noticed at about 7:30 as I was going to get my coffee that the pot of gumbo was still there on the left front burner of the stove. It had not been moved, the pot had not been cleaned, it did not smell as good as it had the night before, it certainly did not look as good as it had. It was getting crusted and nasty on the sides of the pot. No portion of it had been saved for me as I had asked. I was upset for two reasons. One, that the food had gone to waste, and secondly, that the mess had been left for me or one of the other roommates presumably to clean. But I had about 15 minutes before I had to get on the streetcar to go back downtown to work, so I said, you know what, I'm just going to clean it. I don't want to. I'm going to take it up a little bit later, but I'm going to do it because I got time. So I took the pot of gumbo, I brought it over to the sink, I got the soap, I got the scrub brush, I got the gloves because I had no intention of touching this mess with my bare hands, and I started to run the water. Just before I let the water go into the pot of gumbo to begin cleaning it, I stopped myself and I said, wait, I don't have to clean this. Man, I didn't even eat any of this, let alone that I made it. This isn't my fault. I'm not to blame for this mess. This is his mess. Now I felt really self-righteous, right? Because I knew I was off the hook. I convinced myself that I didn't have to do work. So I took the pot of gumbo, I put it back in the left front burner of the stove, and I went off work. I came back that night, about 6:15, to have dinner, and noticed that one of my other roommates was making dinner for that evening on the right front burner of the stove. But now on the left front burner of the stove was still the day-old gumbo, now a full 24 hours old, even nastier than it had been in the morning. And I went to my roommate making dinner right there next to him on the right front burner. I said, what in the world are you doing? I know that you can smell that. It's right under your left nose, so why don't you clean that mess before you start cooking a new one? And he looked at me and he said, oh, but man, I'm not waiting here for dinner. I said, did you have any of this gumbo? Because see, that was the way he was going to accuse me right there. I said, no, not I. He said, well, not I. And now we both knew, through our proper English, I should point out, what it meant to say not I. It meant that we were off the hook. We both felt self-righteous. He looked at me and said, Tim, would you like some lentils and rice? And I said, yes, I would. And I took my lentils and rice, very self-righteous, because we both looked at the gumbo, neither of us knew it. I cleaned my plate, took it, put it in the dish drainer to dry. I went upstairs, hung out with some roommates, watched some television, went to bed sort of early, woke up the next morning at 7 o'clock, a.m. I had forgotten to set any alarm. But this little tip that I probably don't even need to tell you. You can figure this one out yourself. If you live in a house where someone's left a pot of seafood on the left front burner of your stove for what is now 36 and a half hours, you are not going to need an alarm clock to wake you up. Because the smell is going to crawl out of the pot of gumbo, on the legs that it is grown. And English majors, I'm not speaking in metaphor now, nor am I engaged in idle hyperbole. I mean that the stench is going to crawl out of the pot on the legs that it has literally sprouted in the day and a half since its creation, and it is going to crawl out of the kitchen, across the living room floor, up the back stairs, down the back hall, under your door frame, and it is going to find with the precision of a laser that thing on the front of your face you call the nose, and you will be awake. And now I was. Yes. Because I knew what the smell meant. I knew what was waiting for me on the left front burner of that stove, right? Had it not been cleaned by anybody, he said, well, the guy had made a mess. So I fling open my door, I run down the hall, I'm angry. I live with nine other people, can't find one of them. I'm angry. The guy who made the gumbo is like Bin Laden. Nobody knows where the hell he is. It's like he made the gumbo as a practical joke and then skipped town. You know, we'll see how long it would take for somebody else to clean up his nastiness. And I got down to the bottom of the stairs, looked across the living room, across the kitchen. I saw the gumbo, and I was there to count them 19 and a half years later. But the gumbo saw me. It was at that moment that I came to understand. Not a moment earlier, but certainly not a moment later. Maybe the most important lesson I've ever learned at that point, in or out of the classroom, about any subject, not just household cleanliness and gumbo, but about life in general. Right? And the lesson was this. It didn't really matter anymore, did it? Whether I was the one who had made the mess. It didn't really matter anymore whether I was, as the saying goes, the author of all this unpleasantness. The only thing that mattered was that I was tired of living in the funk. That I was tired of living with the legacy of someone else's actions, the residue of someone else's decisions that I had not been to blame for, but which now I was having to live with anyway. And the same is true with human society. When we get tired of living in the funk, so to speak, that was created and generated by other folks for which we are not to blame, we will get busy cleaning, and not because we are to blame for it, but because we are the only ones left to do the job. There's a profound difference. It is more than merely linguistic. It is a profound philosophical difference between guilt and responsibility. We may not be guilty for all of the legacies that we inherit in our society, but we are certainly responsible for how we respond to those legacies and what we do with them now. History is not a video game, after all, where we can hit reset or replay because the game is not going the way that we intended, so we just get to start over. Inertia is not just a concept of the physical universe. Right? You learned about inertia in science class in probably third or fourth grade, right? The idea that an object in motion will continue in the same general direction unless it is stopped by a force of equal or greater weight pushing in the opposite direction, but it's not just a physical property. It's a socioeconomic property. It's historical, cultural, political property. That which happens in one generation affects the next, and the next, and the next, and the next, in exactly the same way and direction until it is stopped by a force of equal or greater weight pushing in the opposite direction. And race is among the tortured legacies that we inherit, or rather racism. It is a legacy that we have inherited for which we are not to blame, but for which now we must take some responsibility as we would anything else. The fact is, none of you individually, I'm guessing, and in this I could be wrong, but I feel confident that I'm correct, none of you individually have gone out, for example, and taken toxic waste and belched it into the air, or injected it into the soil, or dumped tons of it into the water, water table and or the lakes and the rivers and the oceans and the streams of the country, but all of those places are indeed polluted because others engage in irresponsible activity and dump it in such ways, the generation of such chemical and toxic byproducts as a result of industrial processing, etc. Some of that activity is legal, others of it illegal. We all inherit the legacy, and even though you didn't do it, you have to take some responsibility, do you not, for dealing with it? Because if you don't, it doesn't get done. If you were to become the CEO of a major corporation, God forbid, you could not go in. Maybe in today's economy, but at least in theory, you're not supposed to be able to go in and say to the shareholders and the board of directors, I can't wait to make use of the assets that you all accumulated before I even got here, but no, I'm not going to pay all those debts you have. No, that was the last CEO. You really should have gotten him or her to pay that. You know, those loans you took out, that wasn't me, I understand. That debt you ran up, that wasn't me, I understand. All those outstanding balances that you owe on, no. I'm going to use the assets that I had nothing to do with, but I'm not going to pay the debts that I had nothing to do with. Now, in today's economy, you might get away with that. Because indeed, you could be the head of a major industry or a major financial sector, and in fact, not have to take responsibility for your decision. But in theory, that's not the way the market is supposed to work. In theory, you have to pay debts if you use assets. But as a nation, we've been very good about making use and, in fact, demanding that we are entitled to make use of the assets accumulated over many generations of inequity, many generations of profound racial and gender and class disparity, for instance. But that we do not have any obligation to remedy the debts that were accumulated at the same time as the assets, or indeed even to recognize them. That is a shirking of moral and ethical, not to say as well practical, responsibility. Our legacy of race is one in which one group of people, and membership in that group was oftentimes up for grabs. It hasn't always been defined the same way. One group of people, those of us who were capable of any given moment of being called and viewed and seen as white, were elevated above all others, and it was a formal legacy from the 1600s, the period of the colonies of what would become this country, until 1964 as a formal institutionalized process. There are plenty of things I'll say throughout the course of the time together that we have with which you are free to disagree and remain somewhat intellectually honest. This is not one of them. We were a formal system of white supremacy for over 300 years, going back to the days of the colonies. That is not our rule. so much as Rush Limbaugh decided to attack me on the radio and swear that it was. He didn't make his case very effectively. It isn't an arguable point that that is what we were. We didn't even begin to pretend that we believed in equity until about 1964. Maybe we did pretend, but nobody really bought it. Because we'd always said that we were one set of things, and we violated that set of things every single day, every single minute of every single day, in perpetuity for hundreds of years. That was the legacy. We've only begun to even try to address it in the last 45 years, 1964, about 4 years before I was born. You couldn't even extend that to 1968 when the Fair Housing Act was passed, the year of my birth. We are not talking about ancient history. And in fact, it is a legacy that elevated even the poorest of us from Europe over persons of African descent, for example, over persons of Asian descent, over persons who were persons of color generally, such as my great-grandfather when he came from Russia as a Jewish immigrant in the early part of the 20th century, although he was despised as a Jew, the victim of discrimination as a result of his language skills, the lack thereof, his religious and cultural customs that seemed strange, I'm sure, to many people in the United States. Nonetheless, he was able to get jobs immediately. Day one, off the boat in New York City, that were off limits, black people had been off limits that went for over 20 years. And the very fact that he was able to come and catch hell, as so many of our immigrant forebears did, was an act of privilege because, after all, if you were Asian, there were immigration restrictions from the 1880s, really right up until 1965, the year that my father graduated from high school, again, not ancient history. Right? From the 1880s until 1965, that meant if you weren't from Europe, you weren't getting in. So even the ability of Irish and Italian and Jewish immigrants to come and catch hell and work their way up, coming as we all have heard the story with 32 cents of all of Lent in our pocket, that's apparently all of our stories to hear some of our families tell it. Nonetheless, the ability to even enter and to then over time become white, that is to say, assimilated into the norm of the dominant group, was a huge advantage. Doesn't take away the difficulty with which our ancestors faced obstacles and the obstacles that they faced. It doesn't take away from the hard work. My great-grandfather worked as so many of our ancestors probably did. Those of us were like 18, 19 hours a day. The difference is that there have been people of color working 18, 19, 20 hours a day as well for generations on this land. And for many of those generations, they did not be able to own so much as their own name, let alone property, let alone to actually work their way up. Some of us had our hard work met with access to an opportunity structure, and others didn't. That is our legacy. And you may think, well, that's then, and this is now. But there are some problems with that. First of all, it's intellectually dishonest, because the reality is, we like to live in the past when it suits us. We like to live in the past when it glorifies us. You don't believe me? Try going to the July 4th Independence Day parade this coming year and going up to people who are really enjoying fireworks and Boy Scouts and flags and all the pomp and circumstance and guys with the drums and everybody's in this really patriotic mood. Try going up to them and saying, you know, I hate to bother you, but when are you going to get over all this? Like that whole breaking away from the British thing, that whole tea in the harbor thing, that whole taxation of that representation, that was a really long time ago. So when are you going to move on and see how you will be reacted to? The reality is, we love to live in the past. That's what those fireworks are about. July 4th was a heck of a long time ago. Remember that Alamo? We used to tell, well, that was a long time ago. Remember Pearl Harbor? Man, what are you talking about, Grandpa? That was a long time ago. I never would have. We didn't believe in living in the past, history departments wouldn't exist. Because that's what historians do, is they talk about the past and its relationship to the present. Because hopefully they understand there is a relationship between those things. We just don't like to deal with the ugly piece and the legacy of this moment. Of course, it isn't just the past part of it, but it's not only that. It is that inertia about which I spoke to. Just to give you a sense of how that lives on today, we could literally spend an entire semester talking about that. I'll just give you a few very great examples. But one big one in particular. Today, not 10 years ago, 20, 30, or 50 years ago, right now as I speak, the average white family in the United States has approximately 11 times the net worth of the average African American family, about 8 times the net worth of the average Latino family. And in fact, that is the average white family. It's not the average rich white family, that's just the average. When you look at the average middle class white family, they have about 7 times the net worth of the average middle class black Latino family. The average income rich white family, ones who make really good money, actually have about 5 times the net worth of the income rich black and brown families. In other words, even if you're a family of color that makes good money, has good occupational status, high level of education, and earning a top level income, you still tend to have about 1/5 the wealth, 1/5 the assets, 1/5 the net worth of the white folks who are making the same money. So even there, among the income wealthy, there's a huge gap. Why do you think that is? Well, it's not because white folks have worked harder. It's not because white folks are better at saving money. And it certainly is not because white folks have some superior investment know-how about those people of color who are clueless, right? I mean, if there's one thing we've learned in the last 18 months of the globe's economic meltdown, we ought to realize at least this one thing, that white folks, in particular white men, and specifically a handful of really rich white guys, a handful, are capable of taking down trillions of dollars of global wealth without any help from black people, without any help from Mexican immigrants, without any help from people of color at all on their own. And yet we are still more afraid, are we not, on average, not everyone, but for most people this seems to be true, more afraid of the young black man crossing the street wearing a hoodie than we are rich white men driving around in their Lexuses, or maybe it's Lexi, I don't know the proper colloquial term, but in any event, we're not afraid of those men. We're not stopping them and ripping apart their wheel wells and their chunks and going through their glove compartments in search of evidence of their latest financial hijinks, even though these individuals, and as a group, they look a lot alike, they have similar bank accounts and similar backgrounds economically and racially. They have an amazing tendency to destroy more wealth in 18 months than all the black and brown street thugs in the history of the world have been able to steal. Do you realize that it would literally take black and brown street thugs like 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for like 500 years to steal as much in that half a millennia as this handful of venal and unethical and often criminal and certainly unethical, even if not criminal, white men have been able to wipe off the global balance sheets in just a year and a half. Right? They would have to pick your pocket every minute of every day without taking a break to use the bathroom, eat, sleep, anything to steal that much, but we're still more afraid of the usual suspects. Why? Why? Because that's the legacy that we've been given. We've been conditioned to have that response, just as Lisa and Onyanta New York were conditioned to have the response they had in the early 1990s when an elderly white woman reported that she had been the victim of a rape at the hands of a black man. And so they went in at the State University there. They decided that they're going to take every black man who's a student at that college, and they're going to question him, bring him in for questioning. And it seemed like all the black men in the town were in the college for the most part. I don't know if you've been there. Not a huge black community, right? So it's every student, every black male student at the college was brought in and questioned and treated like a potential suspect, even though it turned out, the rapist was a white guy. Sorry. They didn't push the force to find out what the description really was. This woman believed that her attacker was black, so they treated every black person like a criminal, like a suspect, and then they wondered why black folks didn't necessarily feel so good about time at that college, or in colleges generally, where they are so outnumbered in communities where they feel like they're under suspicion all the time. We have this tendency to think about danger and deviance and dysfunction and pathology and negativity in a very stereotypical kind of way. So we don't think about the fact that the 11-to-1 ratio of wealth white to black, 8-to-1 ratio of wealth white to Latino came about not because of better character on the part of those with more or lesser character on the part of those with less, but instead because of direct interventions that benefited some and restricted the opportunity of the others. Because see, that's really why we had slavery. It wasn't a free market. There's never been such a market in the history of the cosmos, let alone in this country. It was the result of state intervention on behalf of white folks. And by that, I don't just mean the system of enslavement, I don't just mean the system of land theft and indigenous genocide and war of aggression against Mexico, which we most definitely started on a false pretense, right? That's not even what I mean. I don't mean the state intervention known as segregation and gender. I don't mean that. I mean the direct government intervention on behalf of white families and white landowners and individuals who oftentimes weren't rich, but nonetheless reap the benefits of those government interventions, like the giving out of 270 million acres of virtually free land under the Homestead Act, but almost only to white families beginning in the 1860s. Hundreds of thousands of white folks continuing to live on that land and benefit from that affirmative action, if you will, racial preference for white, which of course we don't call that. We call that good macroeconomic policy and nation building when it benefits the deserving. It's only when it benefits those who think are undeserving. Welfare. It's not just the Homestead Act, it was the creation of the FHA and the PA loan programs for housing in the 1930s under the New Deal, which for the first 30 years were almost entirely whites only programs because the underwriting criteria that was being used to determine who could get one of these loans, keeping in mind, these are government backed loans. These are loans that wouldn't have been lent by the banks had it not been for the government saying, if the borrower defaults, we will take care of that. We will back it up with the full faith and credit of the U.S. Treasury, which is to say taxpayer money. In other words, by guaranteeing the loan, the government of the United States made it possible for the market in the minds of the bankers to operate more effectively where they could lend the money at less risk. Without that program, from which people of color were almost entirely blocked for 3 decades, and under which 30 to 45 million white folks reached direct housing benefits and accumulated equity worth over $120 billion at a time when people of color couldn't get in on that. Without that program, there is no white middle class in this country to speak of. That literally created the white middle class. Prior to that program, there was no such thing. If you wanted to get a home in this country, you generally, prior to FHA and VA loans, had to be able to come with half the money down and pay off a loan in 10 years. If you were working class, you couldn't do that. So you had to be pretty affluent in order to be able to get a house. The government intervenes, state policy, government policy, not a free market, makes it possible for working class white folks to get these loans and become middle class. That is why the accumulation of assets was made possible for some and continues to go on today, and for others did not happen in the same fashion. It might be worth remembering that the next time white folks who are angry about government intervention and things like healthcare or other things decide to tell us through teeth and through a smile and through eyes that betray no sense of irony or misgiving at the level of dishonesty that they're in that company when they say it, that they never got anything from government, that they don't believe in government intervention in the economy. But yet very few of these people, many of whom are old enough to have gotten those loans, make no mistake about it. Very many of whom are old enough to have gotten the benefits of the original GI Bill, which actually did not go to all GIs and veterans equitably. If you were a black vet, a Latino vet, an Asian American vet, Native North American vet, you didn't have the right to use your GI Bill to go to college in the same way that a white person would, or to get job training in the same way, because the employers were still allowed to discriminate against you, right? The schools were still allowed to discriminate against you. You had millions of white men who got job training and college education under a government program to allow them to do so when veterans of color would serve every bit as proudly and with as much distinction were denied the same. Same folks who say government never did anything for them conveniently ignore that and how divisive that was. Not talking about it, again, being the source of division, but the thing itself. Today, we have other legacies, not just the well-provided. Black and Latino males with high degrees earn on average about a third less than comparable white males. Even when they went to similar schools, they needed to be similar departments and made similar grades, that gap remains about 15% between white and male college graduates. Black men right now with college degrees losing their jobs at twice the rate of white males with college degrees. Now, I know we're in an economic freefall, but it's scary for everyone. Make no mistake, I'm very sensitive to that, and I understand that for millions of white folks are sort of looking down the barrel of an economic freefall, the likes of which white America hasn't really had to confront for like 75 years. For literally, like, you know, three generations of white folks, we haven't had this level of insecurity, so I get that that's frightening. But now, here's what's interesting. A lot of people of color, this is just a more extreme version of the daily for their entire lives. Like the idea that folks might be looking at double-digit unemployment, that might be new for white folks. That's not really new for an awful lot of people of color. So you see, the crisis, though it is real, it was real 5 years ago when it was only affecting those people in that way. It was real 15 years ago when it was only affecting those people. In that way. It was real 30 and 40 and 50 years ago. It's been real every day before it ever reached the rest of us in our communities. And yet, we ignored it, which really goes to speak to just how much we need to have a more solidarity-based mentality. Because maybe if we had thought that double-digit unemployment was a problem when only Black and Latino teenagers were facing it, maybe if we had decided that that wasn't acceptable when only they were facing it, we might have gotten busy trying to figure out a way to guarantee real job opportunity to folks when subprime loans were only getting the poor. Right? When the predatory lenders were only going into the poor neighborhoods, right? We could have stopped it then, but nobody seemed to care. Now, when the overall housing bubble burst because those folks decided to take advantage of deregulation of lending, independent mortgage brokers who are not governed by the regulations of government banks, for example, so they can give out loans without having to prove your income. You know? Banks can't do that. There's regulation. You got to prove some stuff to get a loan from Bank of America or from Wells Fargo or Chase and Manhattan or whatever. But if you go to an independent mortgage broker, all bets are off. If you go in there and call it stated income loan, how much do you make? Oh, $200,000. Cool. Can you prove that? Not really. Well, that's okay. We'll give you the loan anyway. Now, let's just be clear. Poor people were not the ones running this scam. Because poor folks do not believe that they can get away with that. Poor folks are smart enough to know that they're not going to be able to go in and say, yeah, I get $500,000 a year, and have anyone believe them. It's typically going to be middle-class folks trying to live like more affluent folks who go in and exaggerate their income, and then they're the ones who get loans above their means. The idea that the housing crisis was precipitated by government regulations to try to steer lending to poor people, absolutely untrue. The steering lending to people of color, illegal immigrants, quote unquote, absolutely untrue. Those percentages of the loans that went to such folks were a minuscule percentage of the high-risk loans that were being given out by those lenders who were actually fighting most of those loans. They were independent brokers. But again, we didn't care enough about the problem of subprime lending and the problem of predatory loans and irresponsible lending when it was only those communities being hit. And what do you know? Pretty soon, the problem creeps into everyone else's community. That's part of the legacy. Black, Latino, Southeast Asian, Native North American folks, three times the poverty rate of whites, in good times or bad, that's the source of division, not mentioning it. That fact is what is divisive. White job applicants, or at least those with white-sounding names, according to research from the economics departments of MIT and the University of Chicago, have a 50% greater likelihood of getting a callback for a job than applicants with black-sounding names, even when all the qualifications are the same between them. Same years of experience, same quality of experience, same level of education, simply having a white name, quote unquote, gives you a leg up in the job market. That's the source of division, not mentioning it. 2 to 4 million cases of housing discrimination against people of color every year in this country, according to both federal data and several private studies. I realize 2 to 4 million is a pretty broad range, but even if we just took the bottom number, the more conservative of the estimates, 2 million cases where people of color are being denied apartments to rent or homes to purchase on equal terms with white folks, so that if they had been white, they would have gotten the apartment, or if they had been white, they would have gotten the loan at the lower mortgage rate with the lower closing costs and the less points to have to pay on the loan. Do you not realize what that does? Is that not only deprives those people of color of billions of dollars in potential assets, which is obviously a harm to them in the sense that it restricts their ability to accumulate wealth and assets and net worth, but it also hurts the economy as a whole, because when you restrict economic opportunity in communities that, because of the legacy of racial segregation, are oftentimes concentrated, you concentrate misery and you take people who otherwise would be homeowners, who otherwise might have enough assets and equity to start their own business, right? Enough assets and equity to take out loans to send their kids to a more expensive school or get the job training or the child care or the health care that they need, and you make it less likely for them to do so. That has a multiplier effect on the entire society, including those of us who maybe were able to get the loan. Maybe the ones who benefited from a system of inequality, and yet in the long run, that type of housing discrimination affects us all. And none of this stuff that I mentioned is undone by the election of Barack Obama on November 4th of last year. Now, apparently something was, and we no longer have to talk about this. It was as if the election of a man of color somehow meant that all of these names had been addressed, the legacy had somehow been halted. The individual accomplishment of persons of color, though it is important and though it is symbolically very meaningful, does not in and of itself signify anything about larger systemic truth. And we know this if we are being honest, because the same thing would be true, let's say, in Pakistan. Remember, in Pakistan, in 1988, a woman was elected to the head of state. That is your group of the first 91 or 92, one or the other. So Pakistan had a female head of state 21 years ago. We still haven't had one, but my guess is that if you were to suggest that Pakistan had clearly defeated sexism and patriarchy, and that girls and women in that nation, or for that matter, in India or Israel or Great Britain, all three of which also had female heads of state, that somehow girls and women in those places now had fully equal opportunity with boys and men just because they had a female head of state, anyone in their right mind would think that was ludicrous. We laugh at the suggestion, and yet we're being asked to believe basically that same thing about race and racism in our own country, with the only piece of evidence being the presence of Barack Obama in the White House. But it certainly doesn't signify that. None of those things I mentioned have been undone, and in fact, the odds that they will be may even be less under an Obama administration than they could have been under other administrations. Not that this is a knock on him as a president, but do you realize what he had to do in order to even attain this position that makes his ability to raise these issues almost impossible for him? He had to be the candidate of what? Racial transcendence. He had to be the candidate of post-raciality. He could not discuss any of these things. Do you think that President Obama doesn't know the material that I just shared with you about the ongoing disparities, the ongoing discrimination? Of course he knows all of this. He knows it without having to consult a physician paper. I'm sure he understands every one of those things to be true and a lot more, but did you hear any conversation about that during the campaign? No, because this was a man who had to make just enough white folks comfortable with him as a man of color to be elected, and how you make white folks comfortable is not talking about racism. That's what makes us comfortable, is not talking about it. That's why in 1963, right after the March on Washington, Newsweek did a poll of white Americans, right, where two-thirds of white folks said that the civil rights movement was pushing for too much too soon, that they were, in a word, divisive. Right? It wasn't the division that they were fighting with was the problem. It was making all this noise and all this fuss about it. White Americans have never been comfortable at any point in our history with really having this discussed openly, and least of all by a person of color. So when Barack Obama's running for president, he had to what? Talk about racial transcendence whenever anyone would bring it up. He had to shift it back, did he not, to universal programs. So even on healthcare, after he was elected, he's done, he's already won. And a few months ago, the question came, what was he going to do specifically to address some of the racial disparities in healthcare? And not just the ones that were caused by unequal access and affordability, but actual discriminatory treatment in healthcare, which has been documented by 10, 15, 20 different studies in just the last decade. Right? The American Journal of Public Health actually released a study in 1996 which still has received almost no media attention, which found that the health consequences to African Americans of dealing with racial discrimination just on a regular basis, that that can actually be measured and has been measured, and that the consequences of dealing with discriminatory treatment in terms of hypertension, in terms of adding to what's called the allostatic load, the release of stress hormones like cortisol into the bloodstream, which has a direct consequence on hypertension and thus things like heart disease, number one killer, etc., that the effects of discrimination on those things are equal to the effects of smoking, the effects of high-fat diet, and the effect of not exercise. And yet, whereas we talk about smoking and eating badly and not exercising as public health crises, we don't talk about discrimination as such, and you know this president cannot talk about it that way. Because it was indeed his willingness to distance himself from conversations about race that allowed him to win. It was his willingness to distance himself from Reverend Jeremiah Wright. And in fact, he did Reverend Jeremiah Wright, even though Reverend Wright's version of American history, particularly as regards militarism and foreign policy, was far more accurate than the version of American history in those regards that we mostly been taught in our schools and mistaught by our teachers in whatever academic setting we found ourselves. But he had to condemn that in order to prove his post-racial bona fides with white folks. He had to make just enough white folks comfortable. Even as the surveys indicate, no matter whether we like to hear this or not, that unfortunately the majority of white Americans, by our own admission now, I'm not trying to say this is my opinion, I'm saying this is what we say when the surveys are taken. Over half of white Americans, when they are surveyed on a various litany of racial stereotypes, let's say, really fundamentally prejudiced views about black folks or about Latinos in particular, over half of whites will actually acknowledge their adherence to at least one, if not several, of those things. And in fact, one poll that was done in the fall before the election found that 40% of white Democrats said two things at the same time. A, that they still had very negative views about the larger black community. They were asked specific questions about black folks in terms of intelligence, criminality, deviance, pathology, that kind of thing. And 40% of black Democrats were still willing to admit to holding some of those views. And yet, the B part, the second thing they said was that they were going to vote for Obama anyway. And you know what? I don't think they were lying. I think they did exactly that. In effect, practicing what I call in my book, racism 2.0, right, to use all their terms, or to use more academic sounding title, enlightened exceptionalism, by which I mean the ability of some white folks to say, I don't like most of them, but now that one's okay. Right? So I'm going to carve out an exceptional space for that one because he sufficiently channels his inner cliff obstacle, so I'm okay with him to use Cosby show terminology. Again, not Barack Obama's fault, not Bill Cosby slash Cliff Obstacle's fault, but if, in order to be elected, that man of color has to make white folks comfortable, that's not black and brown power, that's fundamentally white power deployed in a different way, perhaps, and operationalized in a different way, but let's understand that that's still the legacy we're dealing with. And let's understand what that means for other people of color. Here we are at college campuses, and I speak mostly at college campuses. What does it mean for people of color? Well, I can't say for sure because I'm not a person of color, but I can tell you this much. I've had this conversation with hundreds of folks of color since the election last year. On the one hand, it's a mixed bag, right? The idea that on the one hand, this election is meaningful. Even for folks of color that didn't support the election of Barack Obama, and there certainly are some who did not, there's a sense of meaning to it. There's a sense of accomplishment and meaning. It is not seen as an empty thing. But on the other hand, there is a real concern that is often voiced that we often don't hear, particularly those of us who are white, and that we need to hear, that we need to understand. It is a concern that because of what was necessary to make President Obama's victory possible, that now there may be, if we are not careful, the creation of a new archetype of acceptable blackness. Now, what do I mean by that? Because we're used to the term stereotype. We sort of know what that means, right? We know what stereotype is usually a negative view about a group of people. It's an overgeneralization. And we tend to know what they are when we hear them. Archetype's a little different. If you look up the definition of that term, most dictionaries will define it basically as an ideal or model type of something. So, to have an archetype of acceptable blackness in this situation is to say, in effect, that for many people of color, there is a concern increasingly being voiced but often not heard, that they have to bring it the way Obama brings it to be taken seriously. That they have to have his style, his erudition, his affect, his cadence. They have to go to the kind of schools that he went to. They have to play the game the way he plays it. And there's nothing wrong with any of those things the way he does them. They are, but make no mistake about it, authentically black ways to be. And the idea that he's not really black, or the fact that he's not really authentically black, is an insult because there are lots of ways to be authentically black or brown in the United States. We ought not ever limit that to one particular type. But the idea that the only way to be an acceptable person of color or man of color is to bring it the way Obama brings it is every bit as stifling and limiting and fundamentally racist as the stereotypes are. It may sound better. Right, we have a lot of archetypes, right? Archetypes don't sound as bad, but they can be just as limiting as stereotypes. So what are some archetypes? When you think about the positive sounding archetype of Asian Americans, right? To take it out of the black-white context. Oh, there are some of those too. The ideal or model Asian American is someone who is really good at math and really good at science and very studious and does everything the way that we, meaning usually non-Asian folks, think that they ought to and that they're naturally, culturally accustomed. These are huge overgeneralizations. Here's the problem with them. On the one hand, they sound positive because you think to yourself, oh, well, if it's saying that they're good at something, that's not like saying they're bad at something. It's more positive sounding. It's better. The problem is, it is inherently limiting of Asian American and Pacific Islander humanity because what if that individual isn't good at math, isn't good at science, isn't even interested in those fields, wants to make cabinets for a living, wants to be a social worker for a living, wants to teach English in a university? Because see, here are the examples I hear all around the country. I met Asian women who are professors on college and university campuses, and they happen to be professors of English. Right? One in particular I met was a professor of English literature, has a PhD in that field, that's how you get that job, right? And yet she talks about how when she goes in on the first day of class and the students, most of whom are not Asian, see her and realize that she, this Asian woman, is going to be the one teaching them English literature. There's like this total disconnect, right? This cognitive dissonance, this total break with everything that they expected. And they actually sometimes have raised their hand and said, so are you filling in for the real professor? sentence is like, so am I in the right room? Because I thought this was English Literature 101, blah, 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 blah. And it's almost this assumption that she can't possibly be an expert in that, even if she was born in this country, and even if she wasn't, if she got a PhD in the field, she probably knows the material. Right? But there's a disconnect because she doesn't fit the archetype of, in this case, acceptable Asian-ness. Right? And so we have to really think about how these things are limiting to people. So on the one hand, we can celebrate individual accomplishment, the likes of President Obama or the likes of any other individual we've been talking about, but we don't want to allow that success to then create a type that we then look for, expect, and need in order to see brilliance in another person's color just like. Because brilliance comes in a lot of different fashions. It doesn't always sound like him, doesn't always look like him, doesn't always have the level of formal education and training as he had. Didn't all go to Harvard Law School. The reality is, unless we understand that, we set up a very high obstacle in the path of other people of color, even as we break one down at the presidential political level. That would be the ultimate irony, wouldn't it? To have individual accomplishment not only not mean systemic change, but actually, perhaps if we're not careful, become a barrier to systemic change, because now we aren't prepared to see it. On a college campus, we need to understand this very clearly. That not understanding these issues and not having this conversation is implicated in some of the conflicts we end up having. That we don't have to have, but which we have because we avoid this discussion like the plague, as if somehow, once again, the discussion is the source of the division. But students who throw parties objectifying Mexicans don't do it because we had a conversation telling them not to. They do it because we didn't have a conversation about why that was a problem. Had we had a conversation, it might not have happened. Oh, the conversation might have rubbed people the wrong way, but people put on notice that things are not acceptable often won't do them. Right? Surprise, surprise. On the other hand, if you don't have a conversation about why such parties would have better check your identification, it may not be funny to people for whom that's a real world thing. People for whom isolated this, say immigration control, raised on a real thing that puts in jeopardy not only their own freedom, but even just the freedom of people who frankly are 100% legally in this country, but who just because of ethnicity or perceived ethnicity, because of perceived physicality and phenotype, will be pulled out and assumed to be in the country illegally, to be undocumented even when they have been there their entire lives. Those things aren't funny, but if we haven't had the conversation, decent people can make that mistake. And I'm willing to extend to those individuals who do those kinds of things, the belief that for most of them are decent people. Obviously, sometimes it's not the case. But I fundamentally believe that for most, there is an ignorance operating. Now, I say ignorance in the purest sense of the word, just not knowing. Right? Not knowing why blackface is offensive, for example. There have been dozens of parties of colors across the country in the last 5 or 6 years where white folks like it would be funny to think their face is black, right? And have parties where they put on Afro wigs and walk around 40-ounce bottles of malt liquor and gold chains because that's the life of the ghetto. They call their party a ghetto party. And that's funny. Now, on the one hand, there's a certain ignorance there. I also don't want to add one caveat. There's part of me that isn't quite ready to cut that level of slack. And here's why. Because whenever students who were inevitably not really from the so-called ghetto have ghetto parties, oddly, people who actually ever lived in a ghetto never had a party to celebrate that fact and let everyone else know. That's not their idea. We're trying to tell you that it ain't really a party top. They have parties in the hood, but they're not ghetto parties like to celebrate living there. That's not really the purpose of the party. When people who haven't come from those communities have parties like that, there's part of me that thinks they do that. There's part of me that thinks they know there's something wrong, right? And here's why I say that. Have you ever noticed that when people have these parties, they never think to themselves, you know what, we're going to have a Mexican party, we're going to make fun of Mexicans, and I think we're just going to call all the Latino students on campus and make sure they come. Like, we're going to co-sponsor, in fact. Like, we're going to call up Metro or La Raza Student Organization, or we're going to contact the Central American Student Association, the Mexican Student Association, whatever group is, and we're going to say, hey, you guys want to co-sponsor? We're going to make tacos, we're going to drink tequila, we're going to have a lot of fun, and you will add authenticity to our event. Likewise, the folks who throw ghetto parties and put on blackface never call the Black Student Association and go, hey, Thursday, we're having a ghetto party, and you'd like to come. come and tell us how to do it right. They never do that, because at some level, these individuals know that the folks to whom they would make those entreaties would probably not find it very funny. So at some level, there's not innocence and ignorance. But at another level, there is, because do we know the history of black facial expression? Now, some of us do, because we've been around long enough maybe to have been taught about that or learned it. Most of us didn't learn it in school, though. Blackface is offensive because the history of that entertainment form was an entertainment form created and perpetrated by, facilitated mostly by white working class people who did not have the proverbial pot to pee in, but yet wanted to make themselves feel superior to black folks. They were getting their clock cleaned by the boss. They had nothing to show for it. They were dirt poor, essentially peasant class. But they could put on blackface paint, get on stage, act like buffoons, act like idiots, make fun of black dialect, make fun of what they perceive to be black speech patterns, and for a moment feel what W.E.B. Du Bois called the psychological wage of their blackness. The idea that, well, I might not have much, but at least I'm not black, at least I'm above them, and I don't have anything else, but I don't have real wages or real benefits. This begins to feel pretty good. This becomes a monument. And so that's why it's offensive. Harkens back to a history of overt immigration to make fun of ghettos. I know people who throw ghetto parties think they're making fun of them. Oh, yeah, we're not. We're just dressing up like rappers. That's what they say. Right? Of course, a lot of these rappers didn't actually come from the some of them actually grew up in some pretty solid middle class communities with families that were very much intact and had money and had college degrees and now they attend. But we won't get into this in that thing. We could, but we won't. So you never think that they're objectifying or making fun of, but you wouldn't even have a ghetto party at all if you understood the history of the ghetto, if you had that conversation. What's the history of the quote-unquote ghetto? It was created space. And the space wasn't created by the people who lived there. The people who lived there got put there and limited in terms of where they could live by, again, the actions oftentimes of state interveners. That is to say, that there was a period of time when the major urban areas of our country didn't have interstate running right from the black community. Then that all changed beginning in the 1950s. When urban renewal came in beginning in the 40s, for the first 20 years of that, all the way up until the late 60s, one out of five houses or apartments lived in by black folks in Great Lakes was knocked down. 20% of all black and brown housing knocked down to make way for office buildings, to make way for parking lots, to make way for interstate construction, to make way for shopping malls, urban renewal, which meant black and brown people removal. 20% of all the homes lived in by such persons knocked down. Hundreds of black and brown businesses in those communities knocked down. Then what do you do? Well, you might think, well, just move out to the suburbs, but you can't, because the zoning and the housing discrimination is going to keep you there. So now you've got 20% less housing to live in, but you've got to stay in the same space. What are your options? You either crowd into apartments with relatives or friends, or you go into public housing for the first time. So the so-called ghettos, particularly public housing, subsidized housing space, was the end result of a process of dehousing of black and brown folks, facilitated by government policy, even as that same government was subsidizing suburban housing with FHA loans. And in fact, subsidizing suburban housing for whites with the interstates, because what did the interstates do? It allowed white folks who lived in the suburbs, where only they could be, to continue to work downtown and go back and forth. So the government directly facilitated the housing of white folks and the destruction of housing for people of color. So that's how ghettos got created, which means it ain't fun. And to have a ghetto party, we talk about that like it's a big joke, is no different, functionally speaking, to the people who live in such places than if you were to have a concentration camp party. Right? I don't mean by that a death camp, I mean, obviously, there's a difference between actually shoving a person into an oven and keeping them locked up in the community. But understand, there were camps under Nazi Germany that were explicit death camps, and there were other ones that were explicit concentration camps where people weren't killed there, they were moved elsewhere to be killed. So if I were to say, let's have a Dachau party, because Dachau was functionally speaking more of a concentration than a death camp, unlike Birkenau Auschwitz, unlike some of the other camps that were very clearly about extermination of not only folks who were Jewish, but folks who were Romani, that is to say, quote unquote, Gypsies, those who were gay, lesbian, etc. I would say that's not a Dachau party, because after all, that wasn't so much a crematorium camp. That was just a concentration camp. And if that's any different than having a ghetto party, it's not. We would all recognize the absurdity of making that kind of thing into a funny joke. But the ghetto parties would somehow think it's humorous when it isn't. So what must we do? We have to have this conversation early and often. We have to be willing to have a discussion about how, very simply put, our frames of reference are different. And it's not about one frame being right and one frame being wrong. Our frames are our own because of our experiences. If you experience society in a particular way, you're likely to have a particular perception about it. And if you experience it in a different way, your perceptions will be different. And it makes perfect sense. And we can use that as a jumping off point for a conversation. But a lot of times we don't, and we have conflict. So when Henry Louis Gates gets arrested in Cambridge, by Sergeant Crowley back at the beginning of the summer, and most black folks said this was clearly racial profiling, and most white folks said it wasn't, understanding what those two reactions happened to be about. They both made sense from the perspective of the framing that white folks bring to the discussion and the peoples of color bring, in this case, black folks, to the discussion. For black folks, they know that there have been plenty of times when they have been suspected of criminal activity, as Henry Louis Gates, the most recognizable black scholar on the face of the earth, was suspected of that day, right? They know that there are times when they've been suspected, so it rings a bell for them. It raises a flag for them. It speaks to something that they either have experienced themselves, or certainly that they've heard stories about within their own community, from friends, from relatives, from neighbors, from folks that they know. For white folks, on the other hand, those whites said it's not about racial profiling, it was because Henry Louis Gates got belligerent with that cop and yelled at him. And here's what's interesting, right? The white frame basically is saying, as long as you don't yell at a cop, they don't do that. But people of color are saying, no, hold on, I had that happen when I didn't say a word to the cop. When I was, I didn't do anything to the cop. And if we're being honest, there have been times when we did yell at cops, when we were belligerent to cops and nothing happened. I've done it on multiple occasions, coming back from bars in the city of New Orleans and got stopped by a cop and was drunk and yelled at them. I've shown fake ID to a cop, didn't go to jail. I was actually breaking into my own car as I locked the keys inside once when I was 23 in the city of New Orleans outside the big nasty outside. I lived there with 9 people that I was telling you about. And I'm breaking in because I got to get up to the school and get my girlfriend, who was a senior at Tulane that year. I'd already graduated, and she was getting out of the class and didn't have cell phones, so I didn't call her and tell her, I'm sorry, I locked myself out of the car. So I'm all panicked, you know, and I'm just going to be angry, maybe you're 23 and care about stuff like that. So in any event, I was like trying to break into my car, and I used to be good at this. I used to work at a grocery store when I was 16 and I sat groceries. Every now and then folks would lock themselves out, and I was the go-to guy. I could get my anger and I could get into any car you had, but I could not get my own car door. And a cop rolls up, New Orleans, white cop rolls up, 1991, sees me trying to break into his car, gets out, walks over to me, does not ask me for proof that it's my car, does not ask me for proof that I live in the neighborhood, does not ask for any identification whatsoever. Instead, this cop looks at me and says, buddy, you're doing that wrong. I said, what? Yeah, you're doing that wrong. There's no way to break into a car. Okay, then. He said, let me show you the right way to break into a car. And he gets an instrument out of his trunk and then proceeds to try to help me break in. He wasn't very good, so he actually couldn't get in. But here's the point. If you think any 23-year-old black male in this country would have been approached by a white officer while he's trying to break into a car and have that experience, you haven't paid attention to this whole talk and have been sleeping for your entire life. Because it wouldn't have happened not once, not anywhere, not just in New Orleans, but anywhere else. And I defy anyone to suggest to me why I'm wrong about that. That's the difference. But white folks have a frame that says it was his behavior that got him in trouble, meaning now he was his case. A few things you should know about this. Number one, was Henry Louis Gates belligerent to Sergeant Crowley? I'm quite certain that he was. He would probably be belligerent as well if someone who was your neighbor didn't recognize you trying to get into your own home and had another person call the cops on her behalf. Because that's what happened. The first woman who thought that Henry Louis Gates might be breaking in actually lives in the neighborhood where Henry Louis Gates has lived for 8 years and didn't recognize her own neighbor, fascinating. Anyway, you probably be angry too. So was he belligerent? Yeah, I'm going to stipulate that he was. Here's why I know that that's not why he should have been arrested. Because in the state of Massachusetts, it's not illegal to yell at a cop. Now, I'm not recommending it. I'm not telling you that it's a good idea or suggesting what exactly do it. The first chance that you get is going to the state of Massachusetts. But what you should know is that in the state of Massachusetts, according to the state Supreme Court, they're the ones who decide what the law is and is not, not a cop. Cops don't decide what the law is. They're just supposed to enforce it. The courts said, on two occasions, that yelling at an officer is not disorderly conduct, which is what Gates was arrested for. In fact, you have a constitutionally protected right to do that, whether it's smart or not, even in public. Not only on your own porch or in your home, which is where Gates is, but even out in public, that's not in and of itself grounds for arrest, which is why said what? They acted stupidly, and like those like Glenn Beck decided that proved the president hates white people. That was his analysis. He clearly hates white people because he criticized a white cop. That means you hate white people? That's what makes you a millionaire and a best-selling author and a leading talk show host? Is that kind of analysis? Wow, that's fascinating. Anyway, here's a guy who says they acted stupidly. He's being belligerent, mean, and nasty, and horrible, and racist, the Cambridge cop. But in fact, what is the proper word for an officer who arrests you for a crime that you didn't actually commit? If not stupid, I mean, it should be the process of law enforcement to know what the law is. Why is it that a gun in their holster and a badge on them and go out to enforce a law they don't even understand? So the president was right, number one. Number two, and here's the bigger point. It goes to how we need to proceed on campuses, bodies, and understanding our different perspectives and different frames. Here's the thing. I bet Sergeant Crowder, the white officer who arrested Gates, is probably a good guy. Probably a decent guy. And I'd be willing to bet that Gates was belligerent. And maybe ideally shouldn't be dead. But here's the bigger question. Is it possible? And we have 30 years of war of social science research to give us the answer to this question. Is it possible that this white officer, in spite of not being a bigot, in spite of not being a racist in any traditional sense of the word, is it possible that he perceived the belligerence of that black man in a way that's different than he would have perceived the same belligerence from a white man? Because that's the only question. If the answer to that is yes, then race could still have been implicated in the interpretation of Gates' behavior, even if the individual doing the interpreting is not in and of themselves a quote-unquote bad person. And we have, as I said, 30 years or more research that says that white Americans do perceive behavior differently when a black person does it as opposed to when a white person does it. Right? Which is why we have this classic experiment that's been replicated many times where white observers of a video are in two different rooms, a group of white folks and focus groups. The first group was shown a video with two actors, one white and one black, were engaged in an argument, both of them men. At the end of the fight, the white actor shoves the black actor out of the way and walks around him. In the other room, the white folks watching, you see the same actors, same dialogue, exact same process play out on screen, but in that room, the black actor does the shoving and walks by the white actor. At the end, they were given a survey. They were asked, do you think that the shove administered at the end of your video was a violent or aggressive act? When the white folks had seen the black actor do the shoving, 75% said yes. When the white folks, and they'd all been randomly selected, so they were equally similar white folks to both rooms, when they were asked about the white actor doing the shove, only 17% said it was a violent act. Same behavior perceived differently. Why is that important for you on a campus? It's important because if we're going to have an honest conversation about the experience that people of color have here as opposed to white folks, we're going to have to be open to the possibility that people of color are experiencing the place not the same way that white folks are experiencing. Even if they're in the same residence hall, or even if they're in the same classes, eating in the same cafeterias, walking around the same campus, that the experiences may still not be the same, and all white people won't be the same, that for some they will feel the burden of representation, the burden of having to represent their entire group explicitly or implicitly, overtly or subtly, whereas for others of us, we have the privilege of belonging, knowing that wherever we are, we probably belong there, and we have the right to feel entitled to that. That is a huge advantage. It is a huge privilege. It is perhaps the biggest, to never have to worry that your presence on a college campus will be questioned as somehow only having happened because of your color, or because somebody pulled strings for you. People of color, irrespective of their grades or test scores and academic merit, know they're often under that microscope on the part of people who think somehow only some special process of admission got them here. Even though a study from just 2 years ago found that for every person of color who's benefited from any form of affirmative action, for every one of those, there's two white students on our college campuses that had lower grades and lower test scores, but who got in because somebody made a phone call, somebody pulled strings, or somebody went to the college in question, and therefore the student was able to get preference as an alum. We need to have that conversation about the differential experiences, because if we do that, we can have a conversation about the differential perceptions. And if we can have a conversation about the differential perceptions, we can deal with the divisiveness that exists, and that some would ascribe only to the conversation rather than to the source of the problem itself. Thank you all so much for coming out, and I'll take any questions. Usually people don't want to ask the first one, and ability to go to Trevor King and George King?
Well, I think that since the time that I was an undergrad, and then shortly thereafter started doing anti-racism work, and 5 years after I actually got out on the road traveling, I've seen sort of these parallel tracks of change, one of which track has been, I think, the positive, and the other of which has been a much more disturbing or negative. The positive track has been that in that 20-year period, approximately 23 years since I entered undergrad, I certainly have seen an increase in the number of students and faculty and staff and administrators who are white, who are willing to take this subject on directly. And it doesn't mean they always do it right or effectively, but there's a consciousness that was not there. There is an awareness that we have to do more than just promote diversity and multiculturalism in some abstract sense, but that we actually have to deal with issues of equity and climate and privilege. However difficult they find it to do the work, they at least are increasingly likely to see that it is the work. So that's good. White folks actually having conversations about how are we going to be better allies to people of color? How are we going to stand in solidarity with people of color? I can also say there's been a parallel, and I think this is also very heartening and positive, increase in the number of male students as men, putting aside race for a minute, of all races, who in that same 20 years have begun to have the same kind of parallel conversation about how to be better allies to women. So on many campuses, you see, you know, men against sexism groups or men against violence against women groups, etc. And that's fantastic. Groups where men as men are getting together and saying, in just male space, right, how are we going to be more responsive to this problem of male privilege and domination, sexism and patriarchal oppression, violence, and objectification of women? So that stuff is good. And that stuff is slow. It's not nearly enough, but it's more than what's going on, actually, a generation ago, or even half a generation ago, when a college campus was. The bad parallel thing, it's almost the exact opposite. Very little middle ground at this point. The exact opposite thing, which has been in the last couple of years, is that there is an increasingly concerted pushback. There was always backlash to this stuff. I mean, even in the early 90s, right, there was a backlash against so-called political correctness. And it's always kind of fascinating. All that any of us were asking for was, you know, that maybe don't use the racial slur and don't tell racist jokes and don't have racist imagery. Well, that's politically correct. I mean, it's just not being a jackass. It's really not a huge burden. Just think about it. You know, you might want to come up with humor that isn't racially or sexually objectifying. I'm sure you can do that. You know, other things that are funny. So there was that backlash. That sort of petered out after a while because it was so obviously a caricature of what was really being asked on. Sexual harassment in the workplace, things that would be evidence of racial harassment in the workplace, and that actually if you can, were being allowed and still are allowed. You can get away with half the stuff you get away with in an academic setting on the job. And so if we're going to prepare people for the real world, we might want to treat them the way the real world will treat them, which is, wow, that thing you did was really messed up and we love you, but you might have to move on down the road. Just something to think about. But so what happened was there was always backlash. Now what I'm seeing is, and I think it's the outcome to some extent of the Obama election and just the fact that in the last 10 years, there has been, I think, an increasing sense, and I think it's been accurate, but an increasing sense on the part of a lot of people, and not just white folks, even some people of color, that things are changing so much that we just don't have to have this conversation anymore. Before, there was just sort of a confusion, like, why are we having it? Now there's actually sort of an adamant, we should be having this because it's divisive, or we should try to transcend race, or we should talk about what brings us together and not what pulls us apart. And what we have is we have people who look around, they see Obama, they see Oprah, they see these popular culture icons of color who have done very well, they've accomplished a great deal. And sometimes we get very complacent. We assume that that popular culture transformation signifies something much more dramatic than it really does. And so we can hear, you know, Will Smith, for example, the actor, and I'll just say actor because he's a much better actor than he ever was. So I'm glad he found this call and stuff, because he had not found it for many years. Smith made a comment during the run-up to the election, I think it was right before the election, made a comment on over that was repeated in USA Today, like the day of the inauguration excerpt. And we talked about the thing he liked about the Obama election was that it just showed that now there are no more barriers and we have no more excuses. I guess meaning we as black people, we still use climate change.
Which I found to be a fascinatingly and really disturbingly simplistic kind of comment. I mean, you know, I guess we have millions of dollars. You can sort of take that stance without hope. In fact, if anything, that'll help you because it'll get you in really well with people in Hollywood. But yet, it's just interesting because if you're going to take that position, how disrespectful is that to the people of color who make that kind of money? You aren't that famous. We don't do that well. Basically, what that says is you guys are just making excuses for not being me. You guys are just like using a crutch for not being rich like me. And of course, the irony being, and if Will Smith had been a rapper, who wasn't the rapper he was, who made, you know, bubblegum, family-friendly, white parents like me, because I'm rapping about some fairly unfriendly stuff kind of rapper, right? If he had been Ice Cube, now Ice Cube, I realize, is also now an actor, but he had made the kind of box office that Will Smith is making, and it's taken him a lot longer to get where he is as an actor, because you know, he came from a very different tradition within the community, and so you don't get to be, you may still get to be famous and rich, but you're not going to be Will Smith, likable, famous, and rich. There's even an irony in making that comment. But so I think we're just at that point where there are people who push back at the very suggestion that we have to have a conversation in a way that before we didn't see before, was just you look backlash on the right. People who said, enough of this diversity and multiculturalism. Now some of this backlash and pushback is coming from liberals, right? People who at least describe themselves as very liberal and very progressive, and just think we need to have this, now we just need to be colorblind and not talk about this. And I find that in some ways more disturbing than the pushback from the right. I mean, the pushback from the right is among people for whom cynicism is the fundamental motivating factor for their concern about being color conscious. Oh, no, we need to be colorblind. Coming from the right, say, there's a cynicism involved there that I can identify. We can deal with that. But if you're coming from that perspective and you call yourself progressive, liberal, and open-minded, and you claim to be an ally, to me that's more disturbing. So on the one hand, what we've seen is an uptick in Michael's really saying, wow, we've got to get this right. We've got to figure out how to do this and do it correctly. And others who just say, why are we doing this again? And I think unless we're able to engage everyone in the conversation, even if we have disagreements at the end of the day about what to do next, which is fine, then we're going to have this fall for seeing a bigger and bigger. And it's certainly run in the last decade. So. Other questions? Yeah. Or just, you know, staying up too late with the light on. It can be about anything that roommates fight about generally, But if I'm a member of a less dominant, less powerful group, I might just shut down rather than even bring that up to the RA because I feel like it's not going to be taken seriously anyway. It's going to escalate out of control. I don't feel as empowered to bring my beef to the RA and have that out and mediate that problem. So I end up stuffing a lot. And I think RAs and residents like directors need to be aware when they do train with RAs about, I mean, there are techniques that we can use to try to figure out what to do when the conflict crosses over power boundaries and privilege lines. There are ways to deal with that, but you have to have that conversation openly. I also think that we have to start very early on in the orientation process by making it clear what the expectations are. I think there's a conversation right now on this campus about some type of social honor code, right? There's already a most any college an academic honor code. The idea is that we expect you not to cheat, you know, not to lie, not to commit some type of academic fraud, that kind of thing, and presumably there are consequences to you. What a lot of schools now are looking into, and what I'm hearing today here, is this conversation about that in the wake of some of these incidents that have happened on the campus, both regarding things like the Mexican party, or like the heterosexist graffiti that I understand was swallowed on a car or whatnot not too long ago, and things that happened like that. And the social article would really call upon members of the community to act like members of the unified community and to say, we're going to call for behavior now, whether or not the behavior rises to a level that requires that the person be removed from the school. That's a conversation we all have to have, and it will depend on each incident and type of behavior. But at the very least, the expectation that will be called out, the expectation that individuals who engage in that kind of behavior will be shown a spotlight on, so that they will have to answer for that behavior and hopefully learn something from it, seems to be the very least that we can do. I think the big picture answer to your question is I think schools like Campbell's and any school should start off with the assumption that they have a mission statement. You have a mission and a vision statement. I haven't been on the website, but I'm pretty confident I know what it is because they all send the team to sound the same. Every college I go to has a mission. It's like it comes right out of the mission statement cliff notes, which is we are committed to lifelong learning in a global environment, and blah, blah, blah. There's all kinds of really nice, lofty rhetoric. And it's beautiful and it's prosaic. It can be written by a poet. It's always lovely. But the reality is very few schools have ever sat down and had a conversation amongst themselves as to how they're going to operationalize those words. Like, what does it mean to say this is what we're about? Do we filter every decision that we make through that lens? Do we say that every decision that we make is going to be about furthering that mission? So we're going to subject everything we do, from admission to recruitment to financial aid to housing decisions to curriculum development to classroom management to training to just everything, through that filter to see if it furthers or detracts from.